Gross, it smells like crap in here, man. Calvin spoke. His voice carried down the seemingly unending tunnel, echoing far past the point our cell phone lights faded. That's because there's probably crap in here. Terrence started with a mischievous grin, nudging Cal with his shoulder. Old sewage and rancid, drugged out bum crap. Cal dry heaved. Gross, man, I interjected. Please stop before he pukes. Terrence chuckled, slapping Calvin on the back and stepping away, taking a few steps down the opposite end of the tunnel. Calvin shuddered, glancing around the surroundings uneasily. Cal screwed his face in what seemed like a near-permanent look of disgust, eyes darting about and frowning as though he wanted to crawl out of his very skin from discomfort. It's always funny, Calvin being the tallest of us, how quick to fright he always was. Cal was a massive kid, just under 6'2 and hefty, with a build for football though he always had lacked the interest. He was something of a frightful giant. I couldn't blame him at this instant. However, we had certainly hung out in more congenial settings than the current. One of the many tunnels in a maze of interconnected defunct sewer drains, running under the old section of town in our community. The idea had been Terrence's, both during one of our smoke sessions in the treehouses in Calvin's backyard. Our conversation had moved from school to girls before somehow landing on the topic of some of our small town's local legends. Eventually, the conversation had turned to, in particular, the story that we had all grown up with since middle school and every kid who had grown up in our town knew some variation of it by heart. The tale of the Cold Lake Three. It was one of those local legends, but of more recent years. The sort of intoxicating blend of verifiable events and supernatural conjecture, sure to leave a footprint in the culture of any quiet town. The story has different versions and endings depending on who told it to you, but the basic details were always about the same. 9 years ago, three older kids had disappeared. This part was probably genuine. They were Katie Waller, Ben Wilkins, and Theodore Foster, or the Cold Lake Three, as local news had dubbed them, students from the very high school that I now attended. I was in elementary school when it had happened, and for that year, it was practically all anybody could talk about. It had been the most significant thing to happen to Cold Lake and the surrounding county in some time. I recall even in elementary having assemblies about the tragedy, and calling for vigilance until the police knew more. As time had passed, theories developed, ranging from the idea that the three were friends and had plotted to leave town altogether, to whispers of a murderer in Cold Lake. As far as anyone knew, nothing ever came of the case, and when a year had passed without so much as a body, it seemed that most media interest had waned. It was around this point that the stories began. I had first heard it at my first middle school party. Dave Christie's birthday party gathered around a bonfire, Terrence along with me. We had all gathered around the fire pit in Dave's backyard, party hat strapped tight, and the high of sugar coursing through our veins beginning to fade, when his older brother Brent had gathered us all together with the promise of a story regarding the one topic that everybody in town knew, claiming to know a side of it that he insisted the grown-ups wouldn't tell us. "First," he began, peering around the gathering of middle schoolers, "who here knows about the CL3? Hands shot up, and sounds of recognition spread through the group. Even at our young age, we had all heard of the three's disappearance. Curfews and allowances for going outside to play became much more restrictive during that time. Our parents often wielded the threat of ending up like the three as a cudgel to dissuade disobedience, wandering too far, staying out too late, the like. What few of us knew, however, the veil of childhood naivety and adult secrecy keeping it from our ears, they were the stories. These were the tales from some of those tasked with searching for the three, and the whisperings that would trickle out from Old Town following the events." Brent smiled, eyes gleaming with a mischievous look. "Well then, which of you little dorks have heard about the tunnels?" None of us raised our hands at the question. Unsure glances passed between my peers and me. He snorted, a forced snort of sound scoffing at us. Then you don't know anything. Your parents probably don't want you guys getting scared, and the police don't want to admit that they're clueless. But when you get older, you hear things. He smirked. You guys want to know the truth? The fire crackled as if on cue, making a few of us jump. A few kids stood and laughed, reaching their limit on scary for the night. After the initial surprise, the rest of us nodded. Those kids didn't run away. Theo, Ben, and Katie. People at school knew them, and yeah, they were weirdos, but not like that. My eyes widened as I began to process what he was saying. You went to school with the Cold Lake Three? I gasped. He nodded. Duh, I'm only a sophomore. It was last year. The event had seemed so massive that I had almost forgotten it was that recent and so close to home. I almost certainly knew people who had known the Three. They were loners, except with each other. I think Katie and Ben were dating, and Theo was Ben's best and only other friend, so they were almost always together. My dad said that Theo Foster killed Ben and Katie because he was jealous. A heavyset boy a few spots away from me chimed in. Yeah, your dad's a moron. Theo passed out in biology at the idea of dissecting a frog. No, they didn't kill each other or run away. He sighed, eyes narrowing as if recalling something that had bothered him. Then what happened? Dave asked. The tunnels, he said, voice low and ominous over the hiss of a crackling fire. They started hanging out in these tunnels under the old part of town. There's an old sewer system under Old Town. They never finished it and no one knows why. But they sealed it off and decided to build the current system that we have now instead. I couldn't see where the story was going, but I felt riveted. It felt as though Brent was letting us in on a secret, the true depths of which I doubt he even knew, and which I wouldn't find out until my nightmare beneath the city. Well, Ben and Theo got bored one afternoon, wandering Old Town and smoking as they always did. And I guess they found one of the maintenance hatches and broke in. As he spoke, recognition bloomed. I had heard of the old sewer line, years before from my grandfather. He had been well past his best days, dementia wreaking its havoc on his mind, but he always seemed to recall one warning. Stay away from the manholes in the old town, Darnell. He would say, always using my father's name instead. Ain't nothing good in this town, and even less beneath our feet. As a child, his warning seemed merely the ramblings of a fading mind. But sitting in that backyard, I felt a twinge of excitement as I began to connect the two. Brent continued. They found a whole crap ton of tunnels down there, some massive. There's never stuff to do in this town, and before long, it became their own personal hangout. He took a sip from the beer that he had stolen out of his dad's fridge, a knowing look appearing on his face as he seemed to dwell on some uneasy thought. It was weird, but they were kind of weird loner kids, so the fact that they took to loitering in sewers, it made sense. Nobody thought anything of it until they started telling these, well, stories. It was Theo first. He swore that something was living down there, that upon wandering the sewers, he had found a passageway into a part of the underground that was different. Another swig and that troubled look had deepened. Different how? I hardly realized that I was speaking until I had asked the question. He frowned a bit. It was much too big, he started, and too old. I don't know how he knows, but he said the tunnels that he found were much too old to be built anytime recently. I guess he started getting curious, he said. Heading in alone in one night, he found something, or it found him. A log popped in the fire, making my heart lurch with a sudden fear. Something chased him out, he swore. He never saw it in the darkness of that old sewer, but he had heard it. Something big and fast and hungry, told everybody who would listen. He shrugged. No clue why he went back and why any of them did. Maybe he wanted to prove a point. But the next time any of us saw the three of them, it was on that day after school heading for Old Town. So what happened? Another kid asked. What do you think? Brent snorted in response. I know what the adults are saying, and I also know that ever since the three, they've tried to keep the old sewer entrances locked up tight. Police have chased off a few kids trying to explore down there, for all the good that it's doing. Why would they do that if they thought those kids just ran away? None of us had an answer, and I suspect all felt much too frightened in the ominous dark of the night to say anything. It's because there's something going on down there in that old sewer. Something the people in charge know about and are freaking terrified of, and are trying their best to keep it hidden. He paused, peering around the fire at us with a devilish grin as if to let the fear settle in. There are monsters beneath this town, kiddos. Try not to get caught. That was our first introduction to the idea of the sewers, and it wouldn't be the last. As insane as it might sound given what we were told, and the story that most kids believed, the disappearances became a sort of an urban legend. With that status, the sewers became a spot for local teenager daredevils or fans of the supernatural to test their mettle. It was a badge of honor to return with your own creepy story of odd sounds chasing you from the darkness, or sightings of the impossible that only the bravest of us had received. While most of these stories were surely exaggerated, or faked altogether by attention-seeking kids, some stood out in their consistency. With youth comes a strange sense of invincibility, and a curious need to peer into the darkness. And so years after that night, I now found myself and my two best friends roaming those very same tunnels in search of our own story. We would get so much more than we had bargained for. It had been Terrence's idea, as these things so often were, a suggestion made over a joint following a horror movie marathon. The anniversary of the disappearance of the Cold Lake Three had recently passed, and as usual, with it came a resurgence in stories and rumors about what had happened to them. The most popular of which amongst our age range, involving the theory that there was something more to the tunnels beneath the city. It had led to a spate of self-styled daredevils and thrill-seekers amongst our high school, making it a point to venture into the sewers in search of something. Though most returned with little more than tales of vague, creepy sounds, there were the few who claimed to have seen them. Kyle Brock swore that he saw something racing towards him in the water one week, when he had been spray-painting the walls of the main line. And Shelly Anders refused to ever return to the sewers, after insisting she had seen a face in some of the gray water. And Terrence, however, was only encouraged by these tales, always one to push the envelope, and with more than a passing interest in stories of spooks and ghouls, the recent resurgence of the myth was a source of much excitement for him. Before long, he had convinced the two of us to venture into the sewers with him in search of local legends. It hadn't taken much convincing on my part. I had been to a few raves in the sewers before, even hung out on the main lines before, and while they were pretty gross, I had never found them quite so frightening. Granted, I was never alone, and I'd be lying if I claimed the miss it didn't intrigue me as well. The idea that we might be our town's excuse for frontiersmen, the first of our class and maybe ever in ages, to venture into some long-forgotten part of the little world constructed underground was exciting. And Calvin was a different story, ever the cautious one and a bit of a germaphobe at that. He had little interest in hanging out in a supposedly haunted sewer system. Unfortunately for him, we're kind of each other's only other friends, and anybody who remembers what those days were like knows the only thing worse than being scared at that age is having your friends leave you behind while they go off to do anything without you. So, he was right alongside us, face a permanent mask of disgust and unease, as we moved through the tunnel. Look, can we just go back to my house or something? Calvin groaned. I rolled my eyes a bit, though I couldn't begrudge his unease. The atmosphere down there was strange. The air was thick with a dank, wet smell that reminded me of the year my basement had flooded, along with the faint but putrid scent of lingering waste. The tunnel's construction was such that it swallowed anything more than a yard ahead in the murky darkness, from which the distant sounds of running water and the grating drip of condensation on the damp pavement echoed. I could almost see how it was enough to make the overactive imagination conjure images of figures stalking through the darkness ahead. I shuddered despite myself. It stinks down here, and I don't even care about these stupid mists. Especially not enough to want to hang out in these creepy old sewers. Terrence afraid to cough. Baby, he muttered in between, prompting Calvin to slug him on the arm. Come on, guys, I scoffed. Argue when we get to a point that we can stand up straight. We had entered the tunnels through a massive opening on the outskirts of town, in a ditch beside the now dry bed of a stream. I was unfamiliar with the entrance, as most people usually just entered through one of the maintenance entrances, but Terrence had other ideas. Having heard about the entrance from a friend who claimed it led to an unexplored portion of the sewers, Terrence decided then and there that it would be our mission to be the first to venture the length of the new entrance. The opening was a concrete pipe, jutting from the side of a ditch where a stream had once run, and space no less than 5 feet wide on all sides, in which only one could see so far into the inky blackness. We had been walking for a little over 5 minutes, heads crouched low to avoid brushing up against the ceiling, which bore a permanent flaky layer of brown that we all chose to accept as rust. On the way, we had passed a diverging path in the tunnels, disappearing off somewhere to the right, and debated using it but decided to remain on the straight path forward. We moved in search of an opening into one of the main lines, which was where people usually chose to dwell down here for their size and adequate standing room. The main lines were the largest of the tunnels, massive cavernous pathways of nearly 20 feet in diameter, with still rivers of murky, gray water, 5 feet across, separating the walkways on either side. Guys, do we even know how long this tunnel is? How long are we gonna walk? What if we don't find it? The steady undertone of panic in Cal's voice grew less subtle as he spoke, his questions echoing up and down the tunnel. We kept moving forward, though he had slowed to match Cal's dwindling pace. Cal, relax, man, Terrence spoke, his tone less teasing but still playful. Bill Marsh told me about this path. It's like a 5 minute walk, then we should see another opening. Crawl through there and I bet we're never before seen parts of the main line. Bet. I could have taken note of the lack of certainty in his statement, but my back was sore and I was tired. Along with my growing discomfort, my head felt too muddled for me to notice. Okay, and then what? We just walk around until what? We hear something creepy and get to run back and tell everyone. He looked unconvinced. Terrence scoffed. I mean, yeah, we're not here for a tour of sewage history. I chuckled, offering Cal an apologetic shrug as he shot me a look. Listen, man, if you're too scared and are gonna complain the whole time, just head on back. You know the way out. Kevin and I will meet you back at the house. He nodded off down the tunnel towards the entrance that we had used. But we've heard these stories since we were kids, and Kevin and I are gonna go check it out. Calvin considered the offer, looking between us to see if either would relent, and then head back down the tunnel. God, how I now regret not stepping in and agreeing with them. Hey, I chimed in. We'll be in and out if nothing happens. Heck, if something does happen, we'll dip. I could see his reluctance or resistance rather waning. On Monday, we can tell everyone at lunch how we braved these spooky sewers under Old Town. Michelle might be impressed. Screw you, he said with a tense laugh. Let's go. And Terrence whooped, clapping him on the shoulder. I shot him a smile and we continued forward. As we moved deeper into the tunnel, it became obvious that we were growing closer to some body of water, as almost half an inch of water had begun to pool at her feet. In the darkness ahead, the hiss of running water grew louder, echoing from all around us off of the dome-like walls. The space grew tighter the farther that we moved, until the three of us were moving in a line. "It should be pretty close," Terrence muttered, the exertion of crouching for so long present in his voice. Bill said it looked like a real tight squeeze close to the entrance. "Keep your lights pointed forward, and we should see it soon." "Sad?" I asked, straining from exertion. "He hasn't used the tunnel before." Terrence sighed, and I could make out a nod. "No, he doesn't come down here much anymore, and when he does, it's to graffiti up one of the main entrances. He said he found this by accident, and that was as far as he wanted to go." I didn't reply, letting the response sit for a moment, and Terrence quickly spoke as if to dismiss any concerns. "It'll be fine, the whole thing connects anyways, and the town wasn't even a third of the way done when construction had stopped, so it's not that big of a place." I scoffed but grunted my affirmation, far too strained to argue verbally as the muscles in my back and thighs began to burn in protest of our continued crouching. The sound of running water grew to fill the tunnel, and before long, it had soaked through the soles of our shoes as we had moved forward, Terrence taking point, with myself and Calvin in a tight row behind him. As we moved, the distinct sounds of us moving through the water became our sole background noise, a repeating rhythm created by our almost regimented push forward. Along with the distant rush, it was the only sound to be heard in the tightening cavern, and it became something of an absent-minded game to time my steps with everyone else. After almost 5.5 minutes of walking, my mind became hardly aware of the noise as anything other than ambience anymore. I think that's why when it first began, I hardly noticed the change. It was the already anxious Calvin that realized it first, a significant detail that the two of us were somehow missing. Having spoken after the fact, the few times we've ever felt comfortable recounting the experience with one another, I know now that Cal had become aware long before he had spoken. That stuck at the rear with walls to either side of him, he realized that if he was hearing what he thought he was hearing, our best bet was to push forward. I felt a firm hand grip my shoulder and turned as best as I could in the tight space to find Calvin staring back at me, his face illuminated in the harsh light of his phone, eyes wide with a look of silent horror. He moved his mouth, though nothing came out, and for a moment confusion washed through me before I realized what was going on. He was mouthing something, a word. "Listen." My face screwed, but I peeked my ears, stepping with measured care to hear whatever he was referring to. All we could hear were the sounds of our own feet pushing through the inches of water beneath us, three distinct steps forward. Our eyes were just as wide as a warm, static burst flash of shock rippled through my very molecules. I'd heard it as clear as day from somewhere behind Calvin. Something else was moving through the tunnel behind us. I swallowed, and for a moment, the two of us just looked between one another, asking the same silent question, our looks answering off. "Did you hear that?" We knew that we both had. For the first time since we had entered the sewers, I felt much like Calvin as my guts twisted into uneasy knots. I peered past Calvin, hoping to catch sight of some other teenagers making their way down the same tunnel, but to my disappointment and growing unease, we had turned several corners since entering, and little to no light reached the long stretch behind us. Still, the darkness that now seemed to mass behind us felt unnatural, almost oppressive, and from within it echoed still, the unmistakable sound of someone drawing closer as they splashed through the water. It was clear that whoever was behind us cared little if we had heard their approach. I considered saying something, alerting Terrence perhaps, and by the looks of it, Calvin was too, but still I shook my head. The echo in the tunnel all but ensured whoever was behind us would hear, a thought that made my guts knot with a cold unease. Were it not for the rush of water somewhere close ahead, now so loud it began to overcome even the sound of her own footsteps, our guest's approach surely would have echoed throughout the entire tunnel. "Here it is," Terrence spoke. I pointed my flashlight forward with his, revealing the small round opening in the stone wall ahead. On the other side, water roared in the tunnel below, rails lining the path for walking visibly on the other side. But there was something strange about it. The light shone and faded as it stretched past the railing, and still it only found darkness. The entrance into the main line was a tight squeeze, almost a concrete porthole to the other side. "Welcome, boys, to the underground," Terrence spoke, beaming back at us, the light of his phone stretching odd shadows across his face. "Yeah, amazing, just go." The urgency in Calvin's voice was almost panicked. Though unaware of the fourth person in the tunnel, Terrence smirked, dismissing it as more of Calvin's usual anxiety. He turned, climbing into the tight tunnel and shuffling out onto the other side, beckoning us to follow. I did next. The tube smelled of rust and still water, and I felt my heart race with the anxiety of being in a space so tight, only to soar as Terrence had pulled me to the other side. I caught my balance with my hand, lowering myself out of the tube and onto the concrete walking path on our side. As I rose to my feet, I got a better look at the chamber that served as home to what was practically a man-made river. I felt my mind waver, a rising sense of tingling unease swelling as it took in the sheer scope of the space in which I found myself. "Whoa," I breathed, the word seeming to travel down either end of the corridor. "Yup," Terrence responded. "Welcome to the underworld." The tunnel was massive in a way I could hardly fathom being possible just beneath our feet. Somehow the ceiling and walls extended out at all sides, until I was certain that a passenger plane could have fit through. "Guys, I don't know if I want to try this, it's going to be a tight fit." Cal's pleading tone came through the tunnel. Terrence turned back with a groan. "You'll be fine, man, trust me, I'll pull you through." Calvin sighed, muttering to himself. As I shone my light around, trying to get a sense of the space that I had entered, I could make out graffiti covering the walls, in various stages of wear and tear, all reading eerily similar or ominous messages. "We never should have opened these tunnels. God forgive us. Abandoned all hope." And for whatever reason, the one that stuck with me the most, scratched into the wall just above the tunnel that we had entered through. "If you're here, it's already too late." I stifled a chill, but it did little to stop the rapidly growing sense of wrongness the air seemed thick with. I pointed the light over the railing, aiming it into the murky gray waters beneath. I could make out nothing, not even the depth in the stream of filth, and felt oddly an odd twist of panic in my gut as I stared into it, as though something might be lurking just beneath the surface. I peered around the tunnel some more, illuminating more graffiti and impromptu art, before the light fell on something that made me stop. At the roof of the tunnel on opposing sides, sat what appeared to be valves, closed with iron lids. Between them was a warning, left in large yellow letters and accompanied by an ominous illustration I can describe only as the outline of a man, with a facsimile of the Grim Reaper lurking over his shoulder. What it read sent a chill down my spine. "Warning, hostile non-human entity. Unauthorized personnel leave immediately or risk death." My heartbeat picked up and I tried to force a nervous chuckle, though I failed. Surely it had to have been a prank of some sort, or some weird graffiti left behind by a prior visitor meant to freak us out. Yet that didn't feel right. The warning looked real and official despite as insane as it had sounded. "Non-human entity," I shuddered. I had not really expected our journey to turn up anything, and things were beginning to feel much too strange for me, my mind running with those vague stories of what had happened to the Cold-like Three. "Cal, what are you doing, man? Let's go." Terrence's voice pierced my sinking train of thought. I turned to face him in the tunnel that Calvin should have already climbed through, yet with Terrence's light shining on it, I could see that it was empty. I stepped closer, that strange sinking feeling only growing worse. As I approached, I kneeled over and could see Calvin standing on the other side of the tunnel. He was trying to stand stock still, his back towards us, but his body shook uncontrollably. "Cal," I called.
"Guys,"
he spoke the word like a plea. His voice was wavering with a sort of terror that I had never heard in real life before, palpable and infectious. "There's something in here with me." My heart simultaneously plummeted and began to race painfully as I recalled the footsteps that we had heard in the tunnel behind us. Dread washed over me as I realized something else about what he had said. Something. Suddenly the story of the Cold Lake 3 felt horrifyingly relevant. "What are you talking about?" Terrence called, sounding slightly irritated.
"Dude, stop freaking out and come."
Guys, it's coming around the corner. It's..."
His voice stopped for a moment. When he spoke next, it was a question. His words tinged with palpable dread.
"Oh God, what is that?"
The sound of movement was unmistakable now, loud and growing louder each second, as it echoed from amidst the darkness of the tunnel. Calvin stood stock still, tension clear in his body under the harsh cell phone light. The noise that came next I still hear it in my nightmares. It was a cross between a moan and a shriek, wet, piercing, and wholly unnatural. It was as though the floodgates had opened and dread had flooded through me, filling my body and making my skin run hot. Terrence jumped, backing away from the hole that we had climbed through, standing stiffly.
"Guys, help me please, it's coming!"
Calvin's horrified shrieks pierced my very being, curdling my blood. I could hear commotion, and in moments saw the top of his head as he tried to squirm through the pipe that we used to enter. His eyes were wide and bulging with panic, his face pale and glistening with a sheen of sweat as he tried to scoot forward. On the other end of the pipe, somewhere behind him, that god-awful sound toed through the air again, pushing Calvin to move even more frantically until he wasn't moving forward at all. He grunted with exertion, one arm out, the other stuck at his side, as he tried to pull himself free and into the chamber that we were in, but to no avail.
"Pull me out," he screamed. "I'm stuck, it's getting closer."
Terrence and I both hurried to either side of the opening, with him grabbing the arm flailing for purchase, and myself gripping him by the collar of his jacket. From just behind him in the tunnel we had just been, a noise like a cross between a choking gurgle and discordant laughter echoed from far too close. It was nearly on him. I tugged, he blooming through my face and my muscles screaming with exertion, Terrence doing much the same, and still, Calvin seemed fixed in place despite his and our frantic struggle.
"Please!"
Calvin's voice was shrill and raw to the extent that I couldn't imagine his throat wasn't practically bleeding. Terrence pulled, wide-eyed and sweating as he did, Calvin's own panic having spread through the both of us en masse. I timed my effort with his heart, pounding in my chest as we pulled once, twice, three times to no avail until on the fourth. Movement. Calvin slid forward just a bit, and I felt my heart roar. It would plummet immediately after. Our moment of respite was crushed, and all progress was erased as, without warning, Calvin shot back into the tunnel with impossible force.
"No!"
Terrence cried, nearly hitting his head against the stone wall with force, while I myself had barely avoided being pulled into the tunnel. The sound that came out of that tunnel was like a symphony to a nightmare. That horrendous gurgling paired with a strange sort of yipping bark that sounded almost like laughter, and Calvin's screams. No longer were they the shrieks of a man in a dire panic, but a wounded and dying animal fighting for its life. I had to fight the urge not to vomit, my head spinning under the steady flow of dread as though I might fall at any moment. Terrence cried out in surprise, stumbling away as a stomach-churning wet crunching echoed forth. With an unsteady hand, shaking like a leaf in a hurricane, I raised my phone,
aiming the light down the tunnel. My heart plummeted into the cold waters of dread rising in the pit within my chest. My vision shook as though my eyes were rejecting the sight before me. I stared through the tunnel, peering into a scene from a nightmare. Calvin was on his knees, a set of impossibly large, swollen hands holding him by his shoulders. They were covered in dozens of fat, wriggling digits emerging from all over, running up the rolls of its arms, digging into his clothing and fleshing, kneading at him excitedly. The skin moved and wavered, and it looked as though smaller fingers were trying to press their way to the surface. The thing's face was still obscured, reaching to the ceiling of the small tunnel that had almost filled entirely with its massive form. But it was clear that what I was looking at was not a human, or at least it was no longer. It filled the tunnel, nearly crushing Calvin to the wall with its mass, an immense being of bubbling flesh and grasping fingers. Calvin's screams filled the air, at this point a little more than background noise to the horror unfolding. Small thin strips of flesh like tentacles gripped at him angrily as it raised him closer.
Please,
Calvin whimpered, voice wavering with unrestrained emotion. The thing gurgled, its face, practically part of its torso, broke into a toothy smile, its impossibly wide mouth spreading to reveal rows of massive teeth. Two fish-like eyes like twin pools of oil peered back at us. Despite its features being something out of a nightmare, there were traces of something human within, most notably its expression, a smile that made my blood curdle, dripping with malintent. Its mouth opened, spreading far wider than any jaw should. My heart fell into the pit of my stomach as I watched it raise my friend until its mouth encircled his head. He stared at us as best he could, eyes wide but devoid of hope.
Go,
Terrence muttered a curse, a voice shaking.
Sorry, man,
he muttered, the hurt in his words shared. We ran, and the sound that followed us as we fled into the darkness ahead is one that I'll never forget. A scream of impossible pain disappearing immediately into a shrill gurgle and a wet crunch. Warm tears stung my eyes as we ran. I felt like a coward, yet any faint idea of returning was dashed by the sounds it made as it devoured him, horrific shrieks that echoed off of the walls as though it were all around us. The tunnel seemed to stretch on forever as we ran, and as these sounds of our friend's end began to fade, the imminent sense of doom gripped us again. We had no idea where we were going or if we were any nearer to an exit. From somewhere in the darkness behind us, far closer than it should have been, that thing roared. Semi knew that its feast was complete and that we were next. Terrence began to cry audibly as we both picked up the pace, his legs surely burning as my own were, hearts thrumming to the point of overexertion. Another roar, closer this time.
How freaking far does this thing go?
I called, my lungs on fire.
I don't know, he called back. It killed Calvin. Calvin's dead and we're gonna die.
As if in confirmation, its roar rang off of the stone walls again, growing louder over the rush of water. Our lights danced along the walls and floor as we ran, nearly blind, until I caught sight of something that, for the first time, was an ember of hope in this waking nightmare.
There's a tunnel, Terrence, over here.
I had nearly missed it as my light just barely crossed it as we ran, but by some stroke of luck or the blessing of whatever god might exist, I caught a glimpse of it. We stopped, something that felt against my every natural instinct, as the very ground shook beneath us under the steady approach of the thing from the sewers. It was another tunnel, not unlike the one we had made our way through before, just a bit wider. A realization that even in the horror of the moment, struck my heart as it recalled Cal's final moments.
Crap, dude, what if it doesn't lead outside?
Terrence said, his tone now awfully similar to our lost friend. I swallowed.
We have no other choice. That thing is going to catch us. It's this or...
I trailed off. We both knew there was little time to decide. Before he could take a moment more to think, I was moving, crawling through the opening at a fevered pace, and I could hear Terrence behind me in an instant. That thing approaching not far behind either of us.
There was no way to hold the phone and make our way forward at a fast pace, so we sacrificed sight for speed, and in doing so, moved forward in pitch black, potentially even deeper into the maze that apparently existed down here. We had been moving for what would have been almost 3 minutes when, from the opening of the tunnel, there was a roar unlike any of those before. Raw with a strange animal sort of rage, it had found us. A sound like the rush of a train began from somewhere in the darkness behind us.
"Go!" Terrence cried.
I needed no encouragement. We scurried through the tunnel like human rats in a maze. The threat of violent death bearing even closer with the sound of a freight train when...
"Light!"
I felt a surge of hope erupt forth in me, somehow pulling energy from reserves I didn't know that I had and pushing me forward. As the tunnel curved, I could see the source, and it was the exit. It was dimmer outside than before, and I could tell the sun had set a bit. But even that little bit of remaining light was a world of difference, and we moved knowing full well that our life depended on it.
"It's getting close. It keeps grabbing at my leg, man. Go!"
As the light grew closer, so did the creature. I could feel its warmth where I was, and the smell of rot clung thick. It was surely no more than a few feet behind of Terrence. As I reached the mouth of the tunnel, I took no liberty with grace, throwing myself out with reckless abandon, sending myself tumbling down a small decline into a ditch in the forest floor. I took a second to gather myself, dazed and with an odd pain in my right wrist, but it all faded as my mind returned to the moment. Terrence's face emerged from the tunnel, a mask of sheer terror, a sheen of sweat making his hair cling to his forehead as he tried to throw himself forward much as I did. He careened through the air and he stopped halfway before snapping back into the ground below. Terrence's leg remained in the tunnel, gripped by one of the fleshy appendages, its skin tentacles all wrapping themselves around him. My vision seemed to shake, a familiar horror returning as images of Kelvin, raised into the beast's mouth, returned to mind.
"No."
I ran forward, pulling myself up the small hill just as it began sliding back into the tunnel, and pulled with every bit of strength left in me. He moved forward just enough that his legs were fully out of the tunnel, though it still held him, but only for a moment. Like something out of a movie, the skin on its arm began to sizzle, smoke rising under the sunlight. The thing squealed like a stuck pig, pulling the appendage back into the tunnel. Its body seemed to shake and quiver until I realized that it was readjusting itself to face us. Somehow those massive dark eyes seemed to burn with anger, the look of a predator deprived of its meal. We stood there in awe and horror, and exhaustion until it disappeared back into the darkness with a parting hiss. After a few moments, the two of us broke down and darted home, both in tears. I don't know what I expected when we told folks what had happened. Of course, we'd have to tell them that Kelvin was dead, but I hadn't had enough time to really think of consequences, as we had struggled to survive. But there were none. None that should follow the suspicious disappearance of a teenager anyways. We got a stern talking to about avoiding places that we shouldn't be, and both of us were grounded after. I know my parents never fully trusted me. Calvin's parents never forgave us, and I couldn't blame them. His name was whispered all over town. "Just like the three," they say. It seemed like already everyone knew, and yet no one had told us. I guess that's why I'm writing this, to tell you that bored kid growing up in a quiet town looking for adventure. Respect local legends, they exist for a reason. Otherwise, you're bound to become one.